Hi everybody, welcome to the session. Thank you for attending, thank you for showing up. I hope you do enjoy the DrupalCon as much as I do so far. My name is Benoît Devos, I come from Belgium. I'm the co-founder and the current manager of a Drupal agency named Webstance. We are located in Mons. So with this session, I wanted to come back on our growth over the last 4 years and see the benefits of a different kind of management. So we rely pretty much on the involvement of the people, our good common sense, our collective intelligence. And today, it's a real challenge, I think, for everyone to hire or to retain talents within your company, I think. So I feel lucky when I look back at our evolution over the last years, and I wanted to share with you what I thought could have an impact in our management. So first, to start, a little of background. We discovered Drupal in 2007. At that time, I was still an employee working as an engineer in a big telecommunication company. And we were doing some coding in the evening, during the weekends, as a hobby, with my friend, Nicolas, who is also the co-founder of the company. Hi, Nicolas. And our first contact with the community were through videos from DrupalCons or through meetups or also through the issue queues. It's only in 2014 that we attended our first DrupalCon in Amsterdam. And we liked it pretty much, of course. Maybe because we used to be scouts together, so we share some common values with the community. Also, I think because we felt we could be involved in the community, belong to something that is bigger than us. And we could play a role, maybe, in this community. And I believe that today this is something which is a bit more difficult to transfer to the newer employees. I don't know if you share the feeling. So maybe an anecdote from this first DrupalCon in 2014. I remember we were discussing on the booth of Wanchu with Michel Van Velt, and we were asking him some advice, whether we should hire a first employee or not. And he was really encouraging us, and he was planning us with 30 people. So for us, it looked really like a far dream, unreachable dream. And we didn't take him serious. But today we are there, and okay, I think he was kind of visionary for us. So we'd start 4 years ago, just before the pandemic, 2019. We were basically two co-founders, self-employed, with a team, with a few people and a few freelancers. And we had accumulated quite some experience. 13 years of experience working part-time on small, medium Drupal projects. Another 5 years of experience working full-time on bigger enterprise-class projects. So we only could dedicate our time fully to Drupal when we had quit our job in 2013. So everything was going pretty well. So why did we decide somehow to move on and to accelerate and to start a Drupal agency? I think there are a few reasons for that. First, we were involved into some business groups, not related to Drupal, and we were inspired by success stories from other entrepreneurs. Then also because we wanted to be able to delegate some work and stop working every evening and during the weekends, so stop working full-time, 24/7. Whether we succeed or not, it's another story. Maybe I can do another talk about that. But still, that was the purpose. Also because maybe with some sign of maturity, we wanted to get some structure and some sustainability for a project. And also because we started to work on bigger projects, more ambitious projects, and we liked it a lot. And we felt like you need to have more people, more structure to be able to convince the customer to work on this kind of project. So the growth was a bit necessary. And this is also something that matched pretty well with what happened to the Drupal community and stopped working for brochure or portfolio websites and go for more ambitious projects. So we wanted to start a company, but not anyhow. Our main objective was for sure not to reproduce what we didn't like from a professional experience or previous experiences. And what we wanted was to involve everyone. So to create a place where everyone could feel heard, could feel involved, and could have the opportunity to co-create the agency if they want to, but they are not forced to if they don't want. Also, life is short. We spend so much time at work. We think you should not get bored at work. It's not always pleasant, but for sure you should not get bored. So we started with these values: continuous improvement, trust, and responsibility to the people. So what we do, we draw our ideal organization. We did that, well, we had to make a business plan, of course, but that was not our driver. We wanted to reach a company with 12 people. And okay, the goal and the figure, they were reached within the year, but it was not our main driver, as explained. Instead, it was more the common sense and achieve an efficient organization. This was also just before the pandemic, and we were a bit lucky because the project never stopped during that time. And today we are with about 30 people. So with this talk, I want to reflect on the growth and see and share with you some of the tips and the tools that we have used to adapt our organization to an ever-growing number of people and to try to involve everyone during the journey. So for us, the two main points were that we wanted to keep evolving, never be satisfied of what we had, and also keep involving everyone. So we had a monthly agency meeting, for instance, since the day one. So involving people, what we did at that time, we were so in 2020 with 12 people. During the pandemic, we organized calls, video calls, and we asked them, how do you see your ideal agency? And so people came back. So we didn't discuss figures or turnover. We asked them, what do you want to do? And so they identified five tracks. They wanted to create a place where they could inspire others. They wanted a place where they could learn every day. We wanted to identify some common values that we could share between us. We wanted to give back already to the community and to improve ourselves every day, so to optimize our processes. So at that time, with about 12 people working in video calls, sharing Excel files, this was working pretty well. But of course, as the company is growing, at some point in time, you must adapt your tools. What we did as well was to define our mission, vision, and values. I guess everybody does that. Do you know your mission, vision, and values of your company? Yes. So no surprise. But these ones, they also have to evolve every day within your company. And so we wanted to involve everyone in the definition of those. And we needed better tools, as I said. So I will share a few tools. So the first one is the World Cafe method. Do some of you know this method? Lucas, for sure. Other people? No? So it's a very easy tool. We like it a lot. So the idea is that you have a question or a few questions, and you spread the people among different tables, and you have one host per table. And then you address the question during 15 to 20 minutes. Then you ring a bell, and you ask people to move from table to tables. And so we can easily come into contact with a lot of people. And at the end of the session, you just wrap up and put the ideas of all the people together. So we use it a lot in our company. We use it, for instance, to measure the wellness of the people in the company, because you need tools and you need to identify the good question to measure what you try to implement. So this is very efficient, and I think we like it, and it's quite easy to implement, and it's working well. Another tool that we use every day is what we call the one-to-one, but it's more kind of a mentorship program. So we give everybody in the company 30 minutes every week to be spending time in pairs. So there is one mentor and one mentee, and they should meet face to face, preferably out of the office. They should not discuss code. It's not about hard skill, but it's more to develop soft skills. And they can do whatever they like. So they can go for a walk, for a drink, whatever they like. And also important is that we do not expect any feedback as manager from these sessions. They stay confidential. So this is very important to create relations between people. Of course, while you're growing and you have a lot of new people coming into the agency, it's very difficult to know everyone, and this is a good tool to have everybody encounter the new people. Of course, we also did some team building or celebration even, especially after the pandemic. It was very important to keep the relation between the colleagues and to keep evolving together. So it's essential today to have these kinds of events. So you understood, we like to try some tools, to follow intuition, to test them. But we believe it's also very important to measure and to collect feedback about these tools and what we are doing, because we need to adapt them every day. So we create questionnaires and surveys, and this you can also do in collective intelligence. So for instance, we said it was very important for us to create a company with the well-being or the wellness of the collaborators as a main target. So how can we be sure about that? So we use the World Cafe methodology, for instance, to create a questionnaire and identify the question that we should raise to the people to be sure we could effectively reach that. So we use this questionnaire twice a year. But that's not enough. So we noticed we needed to know a bit more about how the people feel. So we created another one, which is a smaller one, a quick survey with 5 to 6 questions, for instance. And we use this one really as a barometer of our company. And it helps us to, with 5 questions, to know how the people are feeling, what is the mood. And also it helps us, because we cannot stay in contact with everyone, it helps us to, for instance, if we have the perception that something is going bad, it helps us to not stay with that impression over time if the things are changing. So it's a real barometer. So we use questionnaire and survey for everything that we do. We try to ask people their opinion after the team meetings, for instance, or after the one-to-one, or everything that we implement, even trainings. And we try to adapt. Okay, so far so good. The company continues to grow. And it becomes impossible for us as co-founders to follow and to support everyone. Although we would like to, because we like it a lot. But okay, and sometimes I must admit that we miss a bit the time where we're only 7 and we could spend more time, qualitative time with everybody. But some point in time it becomes impossible. So the new peoples, they have to be onboarded, not only about the Drupal stuff and the techniques, but also about what you want to do with your company, your mission, your vision, your values, your processes, the collective intelligence tools. So everything takes time. So the people, they can help, the team can help, but they themselves, they have also need for answers, they have questions. So we needed to put some structure. So we first search for external support before to bring the capacity inside the team. So we have hired a dedicated office assistant. We have also had somebody in charge of human resources, but we prefer to call him a care of the developer, of the people. And we have to invest time. Of course, you cannot work on customer project during that time, but it's very important to allocate enough time to take care of the people, to organize the monthly meetings, follow-up meeting, listening, coaching. So it's very important. And I said people have questions, they need answers, and we wanted to bring some objective answers, structured answers, and consistent. So what we did, we implemented an HR framework into the company. And with this framework, we could identify role description profiles and set up mutual expectation between the people in the company. So if you get the impression at some point in time that things are not evolving as fast as you would like, the reason might be that you're expecting too much from some people. And this kind of framework, it helps us a lot to understand what we can expect from who in the company. And once you know that, you can share it everywhere. So meaning already during your hiring process, you can already tell to the people what you will really expect from them during their journey in your company, also during the onboarding and during your annual evaluation process, for instance. So this tool, this framework, it helps us to set up the frame, to measure, for instance, the competencies of the people, the performances of the last year, the potential, or the adequacy with the mission, vision, and the values. So during our journey, we also met some point where we ask ourselves, do we still want to grow? Why would we want to grow even further? Does it make sense? And so this is the point where we needed to step back between the co-founders and take time. To do what? To think about our purpose, our evolutionary purpose. So we knew pretty well what we wanted to achieve, the result we wanted to achieve. We knew how we wanted to do it. That was clearly identified. The most important thing is why. Why did we want to achieve these results? And so it was essential for us to determine why we enjoy our work, why we stand up every day in the morning. What's the fuel that runs your engine? What would you be able to repeat every day without ever getting tired? So this is what is called the evolutionary purpose. It's a very important step in our journey, I think. And what's interesting about this evolutionary purpose, so, okay, it comes from the founders, but some point in time, it's transferred to the company, and it belongs to the company, and it keeps evolving. Which means that it can help us as a team to take some decisions, looking at our purpose. And also, somebody could pretty well stand up and speak up on behalf of the company from that purpose. And this as well, you can use it everywhere during your journey, from the hiring process. You should share your mission, vision, and value, but also your purpose. And if you do that, and if you find people who are aligned with your purpose and their personal purpose is somehow aligned with the collective purpose, then you can be sure that they will be involved and they will feel pretty aligned with what you want to achieve, and it will work better. So it's better to be fully transparent about that. So okay, we knew then at that point why we wanted to stand up every day. So then we got motivated. And once you're motivated, you want to accelerate and you want to reach your result as fast as possible. So at that time you think maybe we should define some objective and key result. But I think you have understood now that we didn't want to reproduce what we didn't like in our previous experiences. So we didn't want to set up OKR that didn't make sense to us. So we tried something different. And we're still trying it at the moment, so it's still something under testing. But what we did is the following. We have asked people to start from our why and determine their own objective, individually and in teams. And they present it publicly to the whole team, and also they will auto-evaluate their objectives. And there is a promise is that this evaluation won't be used in the annual formal evaluation. And with this, we believe we can make more progress and a bit faster progress. But at some point in time, we also noticed that this was not totally working, not as fast as we would expect. So we wanted to understand the reason why it was not working. So what did we do? We used our collective intelligence. So there is another tool, it's called the Starfish. I don't know if some of you, you do know it? So it's a very easy one. You ask a question to the people, for instance, why do you think we cannot reach our objectives? Can we not work on our OKR enough? And you ask people, use sticky notes and tell us what we should start doing to do that. What should we do more, do less, keep doing, or stop doing? And you end up with a collection of sticky notes. It looks pretty nice, but okay, it's also fun to have this kind of tools, and it works quite well. It doesn't take a lot of time. It helps you to collect a lot of ideas quite quickly. Okay, so a few more tools. So communication is key, really, and I think it's the most difficult skill to acquire. So we have trained all the people in the company to the process communication model. It's a bit similar to the Enneagrams or the Discus. I don't know if some of you are familiar with some of these tools. No? Okay. So we'll try to explain a bit what's the process communication. So it's about perception. Perception is the way you see the world. It's like a filter through which you see the reality. And you will agree with me that the way you communicate, the way you the things are set is very often more important than the message itself. So we have learned during this training that each of us are developing during our life history the characteristics of six different personality types. They are also corresponding to six different colors. There are six perceptions, so the thoughts, opinions, emotions, imagination, reaction and actions. And those six perceptions, they correspond to six personality. And each of them, they have strong points. So for instance, the thinker, the blue one, is somebody who is organized, responsible, and logic. The persister, the purple, is somebody who is committed, conscientious, observer, good observer. The harmonizer is a warm person, very sensitive and compassionate. The imaginer is calm, thoughtful, imaginative. You have the rebel, who is playful, spontaneous, and creative. And last but not least, the promoter, who is very much into action and somebody who is very adaptable, persuasive, and charming. So during this training, we had to fill up a questionnaire and we received back our personality structure. And so you see we have six different colors and the order is fixed since you were 2 years old. It won't change anymore. What can change is the level of development of each of these layers. At the bottom, what you see is your base. Is the place where you found your resources. Then, the more you go up into those layers, the more it's for you difficult to use these capabilities. So for instance, if this was my personality structure, I would be pretty comfortable into the actions, would be a good promoter, a good sales guy, for instance, but it would be very difficult for me to be organized and to move up into the blue layer and to fill up my agenda or to use Excel files, for instance. So also I want to mention it's not important to, you don't have to see this as an objective to be developed in each layer, that doesn't matter. What's important is to know yourself. And so this can evolve during your lifetime. You can also have a phase. In this example, it would be the harmonizer phase, and the phase is your motivation, your source of motivation. Not everybody has a phase. It can also be just the same as your base. So I think personally that it's a wonderful tool. It helped me to understand my reactions and to accept myself, to criticize myself. And in many situations, it removes frustration because I could understand the reaction of the people and yeah, get the motivation or the filter. So it helped me to understand what was happening. So it also gave you keys to open some useful communication channels. You know, if you should use the interrogative communication channel or the directive, because people expect different way to communicate. And it works everywhere, at home, with partners, with customer, with colleagues. So you could maybe change the way you do your sales pitch, for instance, if you could identify that the people, they are expecting figures, or they expect planning, or emotion, or opinions. So you can really use it all the time. Also, you could adapt your website, for instance, and segment your audiences, depending on what people want to do with your product or with your solution. So if you don't know it, and if there is one takeaway to take from this session, I would recommend you to have a look at the process communication. All right. So the company keeps growing, more people. So how can we address bigger topics, bigger issues? So besides Lucas, anybody has an idea of what we are doing here? And besides WebSense? Nobody? So we're doing a fishbowl. A fishbowl, it's another tool. It's a very nice tool. So the idea is that you use it to discuss collectively, and you organize two circles with chairs. And in the inner circle, you have 5 to 6 chairs, a moderator, and 4 to 5 people who are the experts, or the people who will start the debate, and a free chair. And there is an outer circle with people who are just observers. And you start the discussion, and the rule is only the people in the inner circle can speak. And if somebody wants to participate in the discussion, he has to stand up and to take the free chair. And when somebody enters the inner circle, somebody from the inner circle has to leave and to go in the outer circle. So it's a very nice tool. We use it for a few months now. I think people really do like it, and I also do. Okay, so to finish, a few words about reinventing organizations. So while we were in our journey, we met at some point in time, maybe a bit more than 1 year ago, the work of Frédéric Laloux about reinventing organizations. And so Frédéric, he has surveyed some companies and he has identified and categorized organizations. And in his work, there is a category which is the teal organizations. And we have recognized ourselves a bit, and we at least we know that we have some common goals. And the teal organizations, they try to reinvent themselves to reach 3 purposes. So the first purpose is the self-management. So a bit like us, we want a flat hierarchy. We don't want to create a pyramid. So we expect from people to be self-organized, really to take the responsibility and to be accountable. And for this, you have to create a place where the communication flow and the information is available to everyone. The second purpose is the wholeness. So the idea there is that we should create a safe place where everybody can just be themselves. They don't have to wear a mask or to pretend to be somebody else. They can just be themselves, and they are accepted as they are. It's very important. It's a bit something that we find also in the Drupal community, isn't it? Then the last, the third purpose of the teal organization is the evolutionary purpose. And the idea is that the teal organizations, they don't plan a lot the future. What people are asked is to listen to their purpose and to adapt themselves and adapt the purpose. So we don't plan the profit. The teal organization, they just believe that if they follow the purpose, that the profit will come. So if you don't know the work about Frédéric Laloux, there is a book. It's available on the internet, so just have a look. Okay, so it's already time to conclude. So from the beginning, we want to keep the transparency and the good communication with the people. We wanted to have everybody involved. So we had to have openness and share transparently all the information to everyone. We wanted also to improve ourselves, to implement surveys, collect feedback. Feedback is key. And to improve ourselves every day. So if you are in the same situation that we were 10 years ago, and you are somehow inspired, I would encourage you to start and just hire some people or start a company and just go on. So what would be our next challenges? Well, if we want to stay with these people, we still have to improve, of course. So we need to find other tools, better tools to communicate, to implement our processes. We need still to adapt every day. And of course, we need to find good people who want to join, who have the same purpose than us, and want to take us a bit higher and further. So that's it. Thank you. So there is enough time for discussion. While you're preparing your question through the app or through the microphone, I remind you that we have opportunities to contribute today and tomorrow. And okay, you understood from the presentation that feedback is key. So I want to know how I can improve for the next time. So please fill in the survey, fill in the feedback tool. Any question? Yes.
What is your purpose of your agency? Maybe you said it at the beginning, I arrived too late.
You're lucky I didn't say it. So, the purpose of the organization, I think it was... I know it, but in French, so I've written it in English. Yes? We want to create a place where we can learn and encounter people. We want to work on projects who have an impact. We want to start to be cautious about our impact on the society and the environment. And we want to create a place with the people. So we want to co-create the agency. So this is the current purpose.
Thank you so much for sharing. I really enjoyed your talk. I also enjoyed kind of the workshops that you've been doing with your team, and it, obviously doing a lot of them in person. I wonder, do you come in person every day with your team? Do you have a hybrid model? How does it work logistically?
So after the pandemic, we encourage everybody to come back in the office. So we are there 3 days a week at least. And yes, I think it's important to keep connection and to be in person. It's not always possible, but as much as we can, yes. But it happened, we did fish bowls with some remote people, so we had a laptop on the chair in the inner circle.
Hi, thank you for your presentation. So in my English, I'm French. For me, it's a useful tool that you present. And for my manager, I think it's more a financial issue. Do you know how can I convince him, her to do that?
I think you won't be able. That's maybe something I should have mentioned. I think you have to start from the manager, and they have to be convinced that they want to implement such things, because otherwise it's very difficult. You can try to do that in a department or a smaller team. You can use the collective intelligence tools, for instance, within your team. That's already a start, and this can already help, I think. But if you want to change the whole organization, the manager have to be convinced. And so maybe what you can do is just buy the book and you send them.
So was there also like moments where a new employee came on board, or you were hiring somebody and they were not up with this kind of process, where they we're looking for more hierarchy or less collective approach?
So it's a matter of maturity, and we are not there yet, not fully. So it's true that not everybody is fully comfortable with this. And some people, they do need to get some more direction or some instructions of what they should do. So it takes time. And I think what's important is not to be in a hurry and to take the time it takes to go there. But yes, it can happen. No question in the app or? Okay. We still have time if you want, or we are available to discuss. Don't hesitate to pass by our booth or to have a chat with our colleagues. There are a number there, so if you want to check the reality, you can also have discussion with them. Thank you very much. See you.